Hey everyone, welcome to Five Stone. We're so glad you're spending part of your weekend here with us. If this is your first time to visit us today, fill out one of these cards in the seat back in front of you and then drop them in the offering bucket in just a few minutes. And then come to the Connect Center after service. We have a special gift from us to you to say, thanks for coming. Here at Five Stone, we've discovered that most people are looking for two things. People want a sense of purpose and they want to feel like they belong. And our goal is to help you find that. We think life is better connected, so no matter what phase of life you're in, you're welcome here. The best experience we have for kids from babies all the way up through fifth grade is over at Five Stone Kids. We've created a worship experience just for them. It's fun and engaging, and they can learn about God at their own level. It's not too late if you'd like to check it out. Our volunteers with bright yellow badges are available right now to help you. Wherever you are in life, we want you to feel at home here. In the next 65 minutes, we're going to sing some songs to a God who we love and who loves us. We'll have a time of giving as an act of worship, and we'll hear an engaging and practical message that we can apply to our lives this week. With all of that said, it's time to get started. Welcome to Five Stone.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Five Stone. We're glad you're here today. Why don't you stand with us as we begin our service today? Let's sing this together.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb. Till I met you, I was breathing but not alive.
All my failures,
all my failures I tried to hide. It was my truth. Till I met you,
you called my name.
I'm a reader. Though the tears may fall, my song will rise to you. Though my heart may fail, my song will rise to you. While there's breath in my lungs, I will praise you, Lord.
And put your hands together this morning.
In the dead of night, I lift my eyes to you. When the waters rise, I lift my eyes to you. Now there's hope in this heart. The joy of the Lord is my strength. In the darkness I dance, in the shadows I sing. The joy of the Lord is my strength. When I cannot see you with my eyes, favor eyes to you. When I cannot feel your hand in mine, favor eyes to you. Out of mercy and love, oh, I will praise you, Lord. Oh, you shine through the Lord of life, I feel alive in you. In your presence now I come alive, I am alive with you.
Has quaked before, moved by the sound of your voice, and the seas that are shaken and stirred can be calmed and broken for my regard. And through it all, my eyes are. Thank you. Far be it from me to not believe. Even when my eyes can't see, and this mountain that's in front of me will be thrown into the midst of the sea. Yes, Lord. His name. with me. Yes, God. We are so thankful, God. Just give him praise this morning. Give him praise again. Just give him it up. Yes, God. We bless you, Lord. We bless you, Lord. You may be seated.
Good morning, church. You may be seated. Let's give it up for the Lord again.
Yes.
That we serve a God this morning. Who the waves and wind know his name this morning. He controls everything. Good morning. My name's Pastor Garrett. I'm the discipleship pastor here at Five Stone. And it's so good to be here with you this morning, worshiping the Lord and praying and seeking him and advancing the gospel with you. If you are a guest, we are so glad that you're here today. We would love to get to know you and figure out ways we can serve you. So there is a connect card, a guest card in the chair in front of you. If you would fill that out and give it to us in the connect center, we would love to meet you and love to just get to know you this morning. Here at Five Stone, we believe this. We believe that we are a family on mission. We believe that life is better connected. So we want to find ways to build family and community during the week. And we have many ways that we do that, many opportunities. We have Bible studies that meet here on campus. We have small groups, connect groups that meet on and off campus. We got people doing life together. We got people diving in the Word together on a weekly basis. And we want you to know this, that you are not alone. So if you're interested in any of those, come and meet us in the Connect Center. We'll be glad to connect you to one of those this morning. And we also believe this too, that we have a message, the good news, the gospel of Jesus Christ, that is the only message that can change the world. I love it that we believe in reaching people locally and globally, advancing the good news, and we're going to be about that in 2020 more than ever. There's going to be many exciting opportunities, but one way we do that is through our money and our finances. We believe that everything we have belongs to Jesus Christ. Our jobs, our families, our finances, our homes, everything. We are here to finish the mission of God, to fulfill Jesus's mission that he started. And there's no other exciting thing in the world than do that, right? So one way we're going to do that is through giving this morning. We're going to do that in our time of worship. So we're going to enter into that time and pray as God puts it on your heart to give, to help us advance the gospel this morning. Lord Jesus, we thank you so much for who you are, Lord. God, we thank you that you are seated at the right hand, that you, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to you. You control everything, Lord. And we thank you for this cause that you've given us. We thank you for this commission you've given us to make disciples of all nations, to spread the gospel. We believe this, that the only thing that can change our nation and the world locally and globally is the good news of Jesus Christ. So God, I pray as we enter in this time of giving that you would put it on people's hearts to give to your kingdom, Lord, that we would be a cheerful givers this morning, thanking you and being grateful to you for everything that you have given us. We thank you so much in Jesus' name. Amen.
Five Stone, we love to create opportunities for you and your family to connect in community and take your next step in a relationship with Jesus. Here are a few things coming up at Five Stone that we don't want you to miss. Women, you're invited to an arm knitting class on Friday, January 17th at 7 p.m. Tickets are $20 and include materials. This event is open to everyone in the community, so bring a friend.
Every year, students from our church and local community come for our Discipleship Now. They have a fantastic weekend packed full of fun activities, spiritually challenging teaching, small group bonding, and awesome worship. This year's D Now is February 21st and 22nd, featuring guest speaker Nick Haupt and worship from Landon Wolf. Plus, we're hosting a free concert on Saturday, February 22nd, featuring Christian rapper Jamal Clark. The concert is completely free and open to all students in the community. The cost for this incredible weekend is only $25 and includes a free shirt if you register before Wednesday, February 5th. To make this weekend possible, we have several opportunities for you to serve. We need host homes, drivers, prayer team members, and registration volunteers. Contact me at ssavage@fivestonechurch.com for more information on scholarships and serving.
To stay up to date with everything we have planned for you and your family, find us on social media.
Five. Hey, good morning, Five Stone. I am really glad that you're here this morning, and we are excited that you have come today, because we are continuing in our message series that we're calling Real Faith, because we believe that it's real faith that's going to make a difference in our lives, and it's really what's going to make a difference in the world out there. And especially if you're our guest, we want to give you a big Five Stone welcome. We want to say thank you for joining us today. And if I haven't had the opportunity to meet you, my name's Jerry. I'm the lead pastor, and I would love to talk to you in the Connect Center after the service today. We are jumping into 2020 with this message series because we believe that it's so important that we represent Jesus Christ well, that we represent him with a faith that is real, a faith that is authentic. You know what an authentic faith is? So you probably don't know what an authentic faith is, but we're going to tell you what an authentic faith is today. So I'm glad you came to learn about that. So it's about this real faith. And so I'm glad that you're here. But as we think about that, I want to give you a word to think about this morning, and it's the word faux. Now, you may be thinking like, well, wait a minute, faux doesn't go with authentic, and the faux doesn't go with real, and so how do those two things go together? Well, you would think about that. Some of you may have experienced some things that are faux in your life. I remember back when I was a young boy, one of the hot things when I was pretty young was the show Happy Days. Any of y'all know, some of y'all have never heard of Happy Days. Some of y'all have heard of Happy Days, and one of the main characters on the show Happy Days was the Fonz. Any of y'all know who I'm talking about? The Fonz, right? Fonzie was the cool dude on Happy Days, right? And if you know anything about the Fonz wore a brown leather jacket. The Fonz had a leather jacket that he wore. He was so cool in his brown leather jacket. When I was a little boy, I thought, man, it would be awesome for me to wear a brown leather jacket like the Fonz, and if I had a brown leather jacket like the Fonz, then I could be cool just like Fonzie was cool, right? And so I talked my parents into getting me this brown jacket, you know, brown leather jacket, and I was wearing my brown leather jacket. I was proud of my brown leather jacket, and I wore it around for a long time, and the longer I wore it, the more I realized, well, it's not really a brown leather jacket. It was a faux brown leather jacket. Because what I realized was it wasn't genuine leather, it was faux leather. And faux is just a nice way of saying what? Fake, right? And so if you know anything, if you've ever experienced any thing that's faux, you know, faux leather, some of you ladies may have, you know, your husband may have gotten you a faux leather purse and you wish he hadn't gotten you a faux leather purse, you know what I mean? Some of you may have, you know, not sprung, you know, for the genuine leather furniture and you got the faux leather furniture, and before long, you know, it started cracking, it started peeling, and it started showing the fact that, hey, this isn't real leather, this is faux leather. And before long, you realize, hey, this isn't the real deal. Now, that may be okay when you're trying to look like the Fonz and, you know, whatever, but when it comes to real faith, it's not okay. It's not okay to have a faux faith. What we want to have is we want to have a real faith. And God doesn't want us to experience a faith that isn't real, because there are some very serious consequences when we have a fake or a faux faith. And here's the reality, is those consequences play out not only in our life, but in the lives of other people as well. When we don't represent Jesus Christ in a genuine way, when we don't represent him in the real way, when we're not genuine, when we're not authentic, when we're not who God wants us to be, when we try to be something we're not, there are serious consequences in our life and in the lives of others that we're trying to reach. And so we need to remember that. And that's really what James, when he's writing this letter to Christians, and he's addressing the behavior of some people in the church. He's wanting them to understand that this is how a genuine faith really behaves. This is how a genuine faith really plays itself out. Because in the five chapters of this little letter toward the end of your New Testament, you're not going to find heavy doctrine. You're not going to find this incredible teaching on the doctrine of God or the doctrine of salvation or the doctrine of the Trinity or things like that. Here's what you're going to find. You're going to find this practical working out of faith and living out our faith on this daily basis in this world that we live in. Because God says, I want you to be real. I want you to have a real faith. I want you to make a real impact in this world. I want you to represent me well. I don't want you to be faux. I don't want you to be fake. I don't want you, after a while, when the pressure comes and when things get hard, for you to start cracking and start peeling and to start showing something that you're not really the genuine article. And so these consequences can be very serious. God calls us to have this real faith and demonstrate what it means to have real faith. And so in James chapter 2, we dove in last week on this idea that God doesn't want the church to be playing favorites. That when we play favorites, when we don't treat everyone the same, when we don't love people the same way that God wants us to love everyone, then we don't represent Jesus very well. And so what we're going to do today is we're going to follow up that in verses 8 through 13, and we're going to talk about what it really means to have real faith and to love people the way that God wants us to love people. Because here's what we need to understand. Real faith will make a difference in how we love them. That when we have experienced real faith, when real faith has captivated us, when we know that God has really changed our life, then we want to see that life change, and we want to see that great thing happen in other people's lives as well. So I hope you have a copy of God's Word electronically, in paper form, however you brought it this morning. Get it out, and let's look in James chapter 2. We're going to begin in verse 8, and here's what the Scripture says. James says, indeed, if you fulfill the royal law prescribed in the Scripture, and then he gives an example, love your neighbor as yourself, you are doing well. If, however, you show favoritism, you commit sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. For whoever keeps the entire law and yet stumbles at one point is guilty of breaking it all. Verse 11, he says this, for he who said, do not commit adultery, also said, do not murder. So if you do not commit adultery, but you murder, you are lawbreakers. Speak and act as those who are to be judged by the law of freedom. Now notice verse 13. He says, for judgment is without mercy to the one who is not shown mercy. But mercy triumphs over judgment. Now, what is James really trying to teach us this morning? First of all, he wants us to understand this, that real faith is one that that loves like Jesus commanded us to love. That when we have experienced real faith, that you and I are going to love people and love in the way that Jesus commanded us to really love people. That people are going to be important to us. That people are going to matter to us. That people are going to be make a difference in how we treat them. And people are going to be something that we are going to be. People are going to be important to us, is what I'm trying to say. Now, notice what Jesus does here. This command that Jesus gives us in verses 8 and 9, James shows it to us. He says, indeed, if you fulfill the law, the royal law prescribed in the Scripture. Now, why would James use the word royal law? He doesn't have in mind here that this is some kind of king that is earthly in nature. He's not saying that you have to fulfill some kind of earthly magistrate's dictates. He's not having in mind that I want you to follow the law of some earthly king. Yes, we obey rulers. Yes, we obey those in authority. But James has in mind a much higher authority. He is talking the royal law as prescribed in the scriptures. He's talking about the royal law that's given to us by God, that God has given to us commands. God has given to us instruction in his word. And he's saying that one, for example, is that we would love our neighbor as ourselves. This is the teaching of the Lord Jesus Christ. And James would say, if you're doing that, then you are doing well. And then he goes on in verse 9, he says, if, however, you show favoritism. In other words, if you don't treat people the same, if you don't honor everyone, if you don't love everyone, if you don't understand that God created everyone equal, that God created everyone to be loved, if you show favoritism, then you commit sin and you're convicted by the law as transgressors. Now, let me stop there for a minute and explain something to you. He uses two different words here, and if you notice them in the text, he says you commit sin and then you're convicted by the law as transgressors. What's the difference between just sinning and being a transgressor of the law? Well, what James has in mind here is this. Is this word sin is basically the Greek word harmatia. Harmatia is a simple word that means that we miss the mark that God has given to us. For all of us sin and come short of the glory of God. That all of us are sinners. All of us have fallen short of God's glory. That none of us are free from this area of sin. That we have all done things that have fallen short of what God has prescribed and what God has called for. We sin in areas of omission. We sin in areas of commission. We do things and we don't do things that are sin in our life. But notice this word transgressors is different. He says that if you choose to play favorites, if you choose to not treat everyone with love, everyone with respect, everyone as equal, if you treat some people in one way and other people another way, then you have not only sinned, but you have actually been convicted by the law as a transgressor. And that word transgressor means that you have chosen to willfully disobey God's precepts and God's commands. In other words, it's not the fact that you've just missed the mark, but you have willfully overstepped the bounds and you have chosen to become a transgressor of the law. You're a sinner and now you're transgressing the law, and the law is actually convicting you as this transgressor. And so when God comes along and he says, listen, I just want you to love like Jesus. I want you to treat people like Jesus would treat people. Now, what did Jesus teach us? Well, Jesus taught that we're to love God and to love other people. You see, when Jesus was on this earth, the Pharisees, the religious elite, those who thought Jesus, was trouble, they always tried to trick him. They always tried to throw things at him that would get him to stumble and get him to say something where they could tear his ministry down, where they could discredit him. And so they came to him and they said, listen, we want to know which is the greatest commandment. We want you to rank the commands, Jesus. Tell us which is the greatest command in the law. And when they were thinking about the law, you understand that there are about 400 and some odd commands that the Pharisees thought that we had to keep. These laws were just given to us just to be kept. And so they wanted to know, okay, Jesus, let's see how sharp you are. Let's see how you're going to get out of this one. Which is the greatest one that we should follow? So Jesus comes along in Matthew 22, and he answers this question. He says, well, here's how you need to understand the command. It can be summed up like this. Matthew 22, verse 37, he said, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. And then he says, that's the greatest and the most important commandment. You want to know what all the commands are built on. If you could get this one right, then you would do the other ones well. In other words, if you and I could love God with all of our heart, with all of our soul, with all of our mind, Some translations in another portion, they would add strength. If we would love God that way, if vertically we could get this correct, this is the way we love God. We love God with all of our heart, with all of our soul, with all of our mind. Then we would be following what God wants us to do. In other words, everything else would flow out of that. And so Jesus comes along in verse 39, and look what he says. He says, the second is like it. You love your neighbor as yourself. And basically, Jesus is picking up here from the Levitical code back in the Old Testament in Leviticus chapter 19. Jesus is reaching back into the Old Testament, and he's saying, okay, you not only love God, but you love people like I want you to love people. Imagine this. Here's what our life ought to be consumed with. We ought to have this vertical desire that you and I would love God in such a way that we would be passionate, that our life would be consumed with God, loving him with all of our heart, with all of our soul, with all of our mind. And see, when we get that right, that's going to flow into this horizontal kind of aspect, to where we begin to treat other people in the way that God wants us to treat them. That we see people in the way that God sees people. That we view people with the love and the compassion and the grace that God wants us to treat them. We would not be playing favorites. We would not say that some people are accepted and some people aren't accepted. Some people are loved, some people aren't loved. Some people are good enough for the gospel, some people aren't good enough for the gospel. Some people merit God's favor, some people don't. We wouldn't be saying that. If we loved God in the way that we should, we pour that out, then we love others as we love ourselves. We would be loving in the way that Jesus wanted us to love. That's what he taught. Jesus said, you just love people like I love people. Matter of fact, that's the command he gave. You think about John 13:34. Jesus says, here's a new command I give you. Now, is love a new command? Absolutely not. We're to love God. We're to love people. You can't say that, well, that's a new command. You just said it's found in Leviticus 19. How can Jesus say it's a new command? Well, look how it's a new command. A new command I give you, that you love one another. How? Just as I have loved you. That's how you love one another. You think about the way Jesus loved us. What did Jesus do? Jesus put us before he put himself. Jesus sacrificed himself for us. Jesus came and surrendered heaven, surrendered the glories of being with his Father in heaven, and he stepped down to earth and he emptied himself of that attribute of having everything at his disposal, and he became a servant, found in the likeness of man, and he humbled himself. Even died for us. That's why, husbands, it says you love your wives as Christ loved the church. He gave himself for her. We're to love one another as Jesus loved us. And that's why James is saying there's no room for us to be treating people in a way that is anything less than loving on them. And being gracious to them, being kind to them, and being accepting of them. We got to love like Jesus told us to love. And that's what he's saying in these verses 8 and 9. But then he goes on and he says that real faith is going to recognize that we're all sinners and in need of God's mercy. And see, there's a danger always in the church that we forget where we have come. That we forget that we too have been rescued out of sin and out of darkness. We forget that we have sinned, and we forget that we were in that same boat one time, separated from God and trapped in our sin and trapped in darkness. And God says, listen, don't forget that you were in need of God's mercy at one time. We can't sit in the church and think, well, you know what, we're okay. So James comes along and he says, okay, look at this You think you're okay, but if you break the law in any one point, you're a lawbreaker. Go to verse 10 with me. He says, for whoever keeps the entire law and yet stumbles at one point is guilty of breaking it all. In other words, you just have to break one command to be guilty of being a lawbreaker. You can't say, well, you know, I'm pretty good at keeping God's commands. Well, how do you keep all of them? Is there ever been a time that you haven't sinned? Is there ever been a time that you've had a bad attitude toward a person? Has there ever been a time that you've talked negatively about someone? Has there ever been a time where you've had anger that you shouldn't have had anger? Has there ever been a time where you've acted unjustly? Has there ever been a time where you've lied? Has there ever been? Yes, all the time. We are guilty because we have broken the law. He goes on in verse 11. He says, for he who said, do not commit adultery, also said, do not murder. So if you do not commit adultery, but you murder, you're a lawbreaker. So you can't look at one command and say, well, you know what? I didn't do that, so I'm okay. He says, no, if you break any of the commands, you're a lawbreaker. You are a sinner. And see, when we remember that, it does this amazing thing of leveling the playing field for every one of us. And here's the danger. The longer we sit in the church, the longer we sit in our holy huddle and sing kumbaya and just love on everybody in the church, the more we forget that we too once were in sin and we too once were enslaved in darkness. And we begin to have this kind of self-righteous attitude about ourselves and we begin to look at other people differently. And God says, I want you to remember that we're all in the same boat. We're all sinners. We all have to come to the cross. We all have to kneel at the foot of Jesus, at the feet of Jesus, and say, Jesus, we are sinners and we need your forgiveness. We are all playing on the same field. It's the same for everyone. And we should always, listen, we should always love people and never treat people as if we do not have sin ourselves. Because we do. And that's what James is saying. We're all sinners. We're all lawbreakers. And so it's not time for a church to have a pharisaical attitude and say, listen, some people are welcome, some people aren't. The church isn't a place where we say, you go get your life straight, you go get your life together, and then you can come in and be one of us who are all together. The church has open doors that says, listen, we're all messed up people. Come in here and let's all have God work on us together. Amen? Right? That's what he's saying. So we have to remember that, I mean, you think about that, well, golly, we're all sinners. I mean, gee, Jerry, this is depressing. No, listen. Verses 12 and 13 are so encouraging because look what he says. He goes on and he says, this real faith, it causes us to respond to the love and the grace and the mercy that we have received. You see, the truth is, yes, we're sinners. But the beautiful message of the gospel is that, yes, God knows we're sinners, and God knows that we can't save ourselves. God knows that we're in a mess that we can't get out of. So what does God do? God sends his son, Jesus, who is the only one who doesn't sin while he's on earth, and he's able to pay the sin sacrifice that you and I would have to pay ourselves for eternity. He pays it on the cross, and we reach out and receive the love and the grace and the mercy that God extends to us. We receive that forgiveness. We receive that love. We receive that grace. And we have real faith now working in our lives. And so look what he says in verse 12. He says, speak and act as those who are judged by the law of freedom. You and I are not judged by the law of condemnation. We are judged by the law of freedom. We are to speak and act as those who are going to be judged by the law of freedom. Verse 13, he says, "For judgment is without mercy to the one who is not shown mercy." Now think about that for a minute. Judgment is without mercy to the one who is not shown mercy. But mercy triumphs over judgment. So what is the word telling us here? He's saying, listen, how we speak and how we act is a strong indicator of whether or not we've experienced God's mercy. When you look at other people and you want to condemn them because of their lifestyle, you want to condemn them for the way that they're living, you want to just write them off, you don't want to extend love, grace, and mercy like God extended to you, then you may not have understood the love and the grace and the mercy that you have received yourself. God gave you a gift. And when you come to understand the depth of forgiveness and the depth of grace and the depth of love, the depth of mercy that God showed you, even while you were yet sinners, Christ died for you. Listen, you didn't do anything to puff yourself up and say, "Look at me, God. You ought to die for me. I am so good. I am so worthy. I am so worth you dying for." No, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. We didn't do anything to merit it. We didn't do anything to earn it. We didn't do anything to deserve it. Yet God's love and grace is poured out on us sinners. And we better be pouring out that same love, grace, and mercy to other people. And if we're not willing to give it, if we're not willing to show mercy, then maybe we have not experienced mercy. Do you get that? Remember in the New Testament, there was a sinner, a woman, you know, who had a reputation. She comes to Jesus and she pours out this expensive perfume on the feet of Jesus. She just pours it out. And what did the righteous say? "Whew, what is she doing pouring that out on the feet of Jesus? I mean, number one, it's a waste. And number two, does Jesus not even know who she is?" You know what Jesus said? "To the one who's been forgiven much, they love much." And when we realize the depth that God has forgiven to us, we will love other people in that way. When you realize the depth that God went to forgive you and to love you, how could we withhold that love and that forgiveness to anyone else? Have you experienced the mercy and the grace and the love of God? Then we ought to be quick to give it to other people. God wants us to do that. And that's why God says mercy triumphs over judgment. I didn't put it in here, but Scripture reminds us, what is it that leads us to repentance? Listen, it's not judgment. It's not the person standing on the street corner shouting, telling people they're going to hell. It's the kindness of God that leads people to repentance. Mercy triumphs over judgment. We got to fling wide the doors of the church and say, listen, it doesn't matter who you are, doesn't matter what you're in, doesn't matter where you've been, doesn't matter how you're living, you are welcome here. Yes, we may not agree with your lifestyle. We may not believe that that's what's best for you. We may not believe ultimately that that's what God wants for you. But I want to tell you, we're all sinners in need of God's grace, and we would love for you to be here so you can experience the love and the grace and the mercy of a forgiving God. That's the kind of church Five Stone's going to be. I believe we are already. But that's what we ought to be about. No showing favoritism, no wearing high holy hats, no putting on an air saying, oh, we got it all together. I want to tell you, we need to be real and we need to be transparent. We need to say, you know what? We don't have it all together. We're all a messed up group of people. We just have different messes going on, right? We just have some different stuff going on. I may have this stuff going on that you don't, but you may have this stuff going on that I don't. But listen, we've all got the stuff. But I'll tell you what, God can take care of our stuff. Amen? God's big enough to take care of the stuff. We need to remember that mercy triumphs over judgment. And here's what we got to remember, that real faith loves people because we love God. If we love God, we're going to love people because He loves them. He loves them, we got to love them. He doesn't tell them, you get it all straight and then you can come. No, He says, I love you right where you are and we'll work it out. Real faith loves people because we love God. And I want to tell you, faith, it puts it into action. I like this idea that love does. If we say we love people, that means we're going to do something. A lot of times when we think about love, we think about, oh, love is this noun, love is this thing, you know, and love is this and love is that. Listen, love is action. Love is doing. Love is getting down dirty with someone when they're walking through the deep weeds. You're walking with them through the muck and the mire and the mess. Love says, listen, I'm not going to love you when everything's good. I'm going to love you even when stuff is bad. I'm not going to walk out on you. Love does. And you know what? That's why I'm excited about us reading the devotion that many of us are reading together. And if you're not reading it with us yet, I still encourage you, pick it up. It's not too late. It's called Live in Grace, Walk in Love. It's by Bob Goff. And those of us who have been reading it for now, you know, 11 or 12 days, you know, he just keeps, you know, telling us, man, just love on people. Just love on people and do what you can to get out there and just represent Jesus in this world that needs to see love and needs to see grace. That's what it's about. Love does. Matter of fact, Bob wrote a book years ago. One of his first books was called Love Does. A couple of days ago in our devotion, if you read it, you may remember, here's what he said. He said, the power of love is in the sacrifice and commitment it requires. Sacrifice and commitment always travel with love and action. Love looks like showing up with hands to help, even when we don't know what to do. Love looks like stopping by, even if we don't know what to say. Simply put, love doesn't just think about it, love does it. So what are we going to do? Let's be a church that loves. Let's be a church that reaches out and cares for people. Opens wide our doors and says, listen, we want you to come in here. We want you to hear about the good news of Jesus Christ. We want you to hear about a God who loves you enough to die for you right where you are, no matter where you've been, no matter what you've done. So I've got a challenge this week. How can you put your real faith into action this week? Do you have real faith? Have you ever experienced the love and the grace and mercy of God? Well, listen, how can you extend that to someone else this week? What is there something you can do this week to put love into action? Maybe it's a phone call and say, hey, can I come over? Can I help you at your house? I heard you're not feeling well. Is there something I can do for you? Can we go grab coffee? Can we talk? How can I help you? You going through a hard time? I want to be here for you. Just be the hands and feet of Jesus. This world is so impersonal. Be a personal touch. Reach out to someone. Put your real faith into action this week. And think about just one thing you can do to love on someone this week. Doesn't have to be hard. Doesn't have to be huge. Could be something simple. But that's how we demonstrate real faith. We're all sinners in need of the love and the grace and the mercy of God. And if you've received it, then extend it. Because mercy triumphs over judgment. If you're here today and you've never experienced that love and that grace and that mercy of God, I want to tell you, Jesus loves you right where you are. No matter who you are, no matter where you've been, no matter what you've done, you have a God who loves you enough to cancel out every wrong, every attitude, every sin, every transgression, anything in your life that has displeased him. He can take care of that. If you'll simply come in faith and say, Jesus, I've sinned, I've messed up, I can't fix it on my own. In faith, I'm coming to you. I confess you as Lord, as King of Kings, Lord of Lords. You rose from the dead. I believe that with my heart. If you believe that with your heart, confess with your mouth that he's Lord. And just say, save me, Jesus. He will. You'll become a child of God. The Holy Spirit will live inside of you. And you'll begin to have a real faith that'll begin to love on people like God wants you to love on people. If you've never had that happen in your life, make it happen today. Just call out to Jesus in this room right now. Would you bow your heads? Father, I pray this morning that you would help us be obedient to your word. And thank you for giving us real faith. And I pray that Five Stone would be a church of real faith, that we would put love into action, that we would be people who not only talk about it, but God, who do it. There are people who need us, who need to experience the love, the grace, and the mercy that you have extended to us. And so, Father, I pray this morning that we would be people who reach out in love to those who need to be loved. Father, I'm praying for someone who hears my voice, maybe in this room, maybe on the web this morning. I pray, God, that if they're not in relationship with you, would you draw them to yourself right now? Just let them know that you love them and you care for them and you want them to experience forgiveness and grace and mercy. Thank you for your gospel. Thank you for the good news, God. Thank you that mercy triumphs over judgment. You're such a good God. And we pray these things in the name of Jesus, who is Lord and who is our Savior. Amen. Would you stand to your feet? Our prayer team is going to be here because we want to respond. Maybe you have a prayer need today. Maybe you trusted Christ and you need to tell someone. Don't keep that to yourself. It's a time for us to do what God's telling us to do. As our worship team leads us, the prayer team will be here. You come.
Soften my heart. to pierce through the dark and cleanse every part of me.
Grateful that you guys chose Five Stone to be with us here today. If you have any questions about next steps or want to know more information about Five Stone, please go visit our pastors in the Connect Center. They really want to meet you. Have a great week. We will see you on Sunday.
ever the one I